This is breaking news.
Never mind who you thought I was. I'm Rick James, bitch.
The one and only, the original. I was born by the river. I was shaking that ass, bending over, popping pussy. I was making that cat. Bring that ass here, boy. Turn up. Fuck you, man.
What's up? What's up, you guys? You already know what it is. It is Illustrate Radio right here on WEMS. I am T. Gray. And of course, I have with me in the building my lovely co-host, Lucky. What's up, Lucky?
How you doing, baby? Well, I'm going T. Gray. You're going to
not the motherfucking team.
Love it.
Listen, nothing. Happy Wednesday. Happy Wednesday to everybody, you guys. Make sure that you are always tuned into us right here every week. And if you don't see us here, make sure you hop on your Roku, download your 7 On Demand app, catch us there every Wednesday also at 8 o'clock. Get us on YouTube, get us on Facebook, get us on Twitch, get us everywhere, you guys, every platform. So definitely keep up with what Illustrate Radio has going on. We got a great show tonight. Guys, we're waiting on DJ Stiletto to come into the building. I'm looking forward to that mix in the second half. We have a fantastic guest tonight, journalist, editor, writer, jack of all trades, master, damn near everything when it comes to hip hop and hip hop knowledge. Soren Baker is going to be in the building with us in the second half. But we're going to go ahead and get this jump started. You wanna start, everybody, with your Just My Love?
Oh, I don't mind, because my Just My Luck is really great. I can't wait. Yes, let's get into it. Just
no,
my
don't
luck.
Give me the,
do
don't
it.
Give me the greatness. Don't give me the greatness.
Welcome to another episode of Just My Luck. Yeah. All right. So imitation is not, I mean, inspiration. No, I'm sorry. I'm going to start over again. I'm sorry. Because I need to calm down. Imitation is a part of inspiration. You should be flattered when you inspire someone else's growth or any part of their success or anything that they're doing. Even if it's someone's fashion sense, the way they think about things, their characteristics, the lingo that you may speak, because remember, we are very vibrational beings. So we all vibrate on frequencies. And sometimes it's a beautiful thing. Well, to me, all the time, it's a beautiful thing when you can inspire someone else's success and growth. So don't think that, you know what I'm saying? It's good to have a purpose in anything that you do, because your passion, right? In order for it to leave a legacy, it should have a service to others. And if I'm not adding, I am taking away. So I would rather be an addition than to be a subtraction. So shout out to all of the people that have inspired me, and shout out to the people that I look forward to inspiring. And that is it for Just My Luck.
Well, all right then. And so I can attest that what she said was true, because when a bitch came in today, I said, you know what? Let me change my clothes, because you're bright and I'm solid. And so I went and pulled out some bright shit. Luckily, I am a girl with a chair in her room that has clothes in it. And I'm like,
let me go pick that out real quick. No, because I was at work and somebody got pretty angry about someone else like mocking the technique that they use to get things accomplished. And I'm like, why would you be upset about that? If it makes sense, let's all do it. You know what I'm saying? Listen, let's all do it.
At the workplace, the work smarter, not harder.
That is my goal. I'm not.
And I don't know why
she was hovering over me. I mean, why are you mad at that?
I've never understood why the choice to work harder is status quo. Mm-hmm. When you can get this done, we can get home sooner. Or I can get back to chilling, because that's what I came to work to do in the first place.
Look, let me do that. Let me do that.
So we're going to move right along, you guys, to my love and... So today's love and is love and internal truth. I know a lot of times, you guys, we have a problem with dealing with who we really are on the inside. And a lot of times We focus so much on the superficial. We don't necessarily want to dig through those layers. We don't want to pull back those pieces of the onion to realize what's really happening at our core. And so something happened today that made me think about that. On the side, you guys, I do relationship, sex advice, what have you. Somebody stopped me in the store. It was like, T, I need to tell you this. I need to tell you that. I'm like, okay, you know, run this by me. Fast forward the conversation. The point that I wanted to make to the person who asked for the advice is, what is it at your core that makes it okay for you to accept the treatment or whatever it is that you're receiving? What is it at your core? And the person was like, no, it's nothing wrong. It's nothing inside of me. It's nothing that I should address. It's nothing that I should fix. Nothing I got to work on. It's them. A lot of times in life, you guys, it's not always them. And a lot of times in life, you guys, it's not always only what we see on the surface of other people's actions. You have to sometimes consider what is happening underneath the surface, what's happening at your own core that makes you accepting of the actions, that makes you feel like you are worthy and or worthless in how you maintain and deal with people around you. So I would love for people just to start being accountable for one, their self-worth, and then being accountable for their core, you guys. If you have a sore, you got a pimple, you got something that need to be busted, you could push all that white shit out all you want to. If you don't get the core, it's just going to come back. So that's the same euphemism for life and relationships and the things that you deal with. You could push out all the mess, but if you don't get the core, it's going to keep happening. So start to understand that everything that happens isn't always surface. Focus on what may be at the core. What's at the root of the problem? If you fix the root and if you get to the core of it, and then you can begin to heal. Once you get that out, then you can heal, then you can grow, then you can elevate, then your mind is open, then you now see what your worthiness is, and you'll now see that the treatment that you receive is not worthy of who you are at your center and at your core. So 2022, you guys, take that shit with you. Be mindful of your own self-worth, be patient with your core, fix that shit.
Internal to external, I'm with it. Hey, that's the way to bring it home. Internal accountability. That's all we doing.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yes. So you guys, we're gonna go ahead and jump into that spit that
is yours.
All right, so here it is. You guys, I know that you have heard so many stories before. This story is only one of many of where I feel as if privilege really just ran a fucking muck. That's T. Gray's opinion. In North Carolina, a school came under fire following a mock slavery auction where Black students were sold to white students. There's always reenactments and things of this nature that happen. If you go to Williamsburg, you can go to a restaurant that literally is based on this same method and has the Black staff treated as slaves and people pay to go there. But in this school, you guys, and in 2022, I feel like we really should get away from this in the school system. So according to the Charlotte News and Observer, in Chatham County, a school system in North Carolina has some, they got a little bit explaining to do after they engaged in the mock slavery auction during, you know, literal kids are on stage and white kids are bidding on them. Parents feel like this is just a flagrant display of caucasity, you know. I want to know, Lucky, what do you think about this? If this were your child, your school system, how would you feel as a parent?
I'm sorry, my mic was muted. I said this wouldn't be my child. It wouldn't be my child because my child is going knows at the age of 7 and 11 that we are not doing any slave reenactments of any sort. You are a person of value, not a person of color. Okay. Mm-hmm. So at the mm-hmm. end of the day, I mean, people would say you are a person of color, but I don't like to say you're a color person. Mm-hmm. You're a Nubian Moorish being. And that's, we're not doing that. We're not doing anything that's going to degrade or take away your self-worth. So that's the first thing we need to do, because like we say, inner outer. So mm-hmm. I'm not going to blame them as well, but I'm also going to say, as parents, we need to take accountability and teach our kids the difference of certain things that are appropriate and not inappropriate. Ooh, yes, we lit. She brought it all together, baby. Yes, look at all hosts and welcome in DJ Stiletto. So yeah, we know we're not doing that. And if that was my child, I would be livid. Okay. I would withdraw my child from out of that school. And so every person who ever thought of the idea and everybody involved, I don't even want them in that environment. So yeah, they're getting withdrawn out the school. Simple.
So what's up, DJ Stiletto?
Sorry for the lateness. I walked in and my mother was actually helping me out by making my kids some food, and she spilled the boiling water on herself.
Oh.
So we're trying to figure out whether I need to take her to the emergency room or not.
So how bad is the burn? Like, has it blistered?
Yeah, burn. Well, my mother has very sensitive skin because she has really bad arthritis.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I'm telling all my mother business. Hey, Teddy. Okay, but
look. Well, at least you're telling it to an EMT. That's why I'm asking, so I can tell you.
Oh, that. Well, see, yeah.
I know we live, but
some of it is on her belly, and some of the skin did peel off. So she went and washed it with cold water. I put Neosporin on it. She did get some on her foot too, but again, she bruises really fast, and she also like all of this stuff.
Bye. Like, say bye.
Hey, as soon as you do like a little elbow, like and she's light skinned, so she's fair. So you can see it like purple, red, all the colors of the rainbow, like real fast. So her foot is actually swollen. So I think that is more of a concern than actually on her tongue. So I said, you know, I'll finish out the show and then I'll go and check on it now. I just finished out sharing out food and stuff. So I just want to make sure everybody is
good. Level. As you should.
Which is like, you know, the kids, you know, oh, mom. And I'm just like,
right.
I just walked in. Wait a minute.
Oh, I'm sorry about that, mom.
Sorry, too.
Mom.
Sorry. I mean, you know, it happens. But, I'm glad that you are EMT. You can answer those questions. I mean, I'm medically inclined, but you know, it's good to have the go now instead of the just wait it out. But
yeah.
All right, we'll talk when the show is out.
Yeah, for sure.
I just want to see how the foot is. But
yeah, most definitely for the swelling. Then the area where the skin is broken, that probably will blister. So you do want to get something for that burn. Like if you don't have on hand a burn cream, anything that's like second degree or how you should
have. Yeah, I might go to the CVS. Out. We have 24-hour CVS's around the corner. I might just go ahead and do that after I leave here. So yeah.
Sorry about that, mom.
Yeah, me too. And if you got some aloe vera too, that'll cool the skin.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, if you got a plant, you could just pop it and put it on there.
We don't have plants. That's Lucky's department right there.
Yo, that's how I found out I was allergic to aloe.
So really?
I'm probably the only person in the world who is. But I grew up.
I'm so glad I know that.
I grew up in a house with a lot of plants.
Hello, what did you do?
And when I was a kid, I used to rub it on me, like because I saw my grandmother doing that. So randomly, I would just break the plants, start putting the shit on me, and I'm allergic. I'm allergic like shit. This is ridiculous. I'm allergic to aloe.
Is that like your only allergy?
Holistic things that don't make no sense. I can't have echinacea. I can't have guarana. I can't have like random like. A lot of holistic things.
That
I
is can't awkward. Do. You are the first person that has ever. Wow.
Yeah. Like even you know how they used to have aloe gloves and medical fields. Like they just would break me totally out. Like I can't hives and it gets bad swelling. Yeah, I'm weird like that, but it's okay. So real quick, you guys, because daylight savings time just came upon us. Everybody was tired. Okay. Because we got that we sprung forward and lost that hour, but now there's a Senate bill passes, you guys, to make daylight saving times permanent. Now heads to the House. So if you are tired of changing your clocks twice a year, you may not have to. Beginning in 2023. Now, what a lot of people don't know is every state has a say-so in their daylight saving times. And so there are some states who have never participated. And there are some states who in the past 5 to 10 years have been like, nah, we're not going to do it no more. And so you literally can be in one state that says it's six and be the next day and they'd be like, nah, it's still seven. You know what I mean? So that's very interesting. What? So they're trying
to have a list of those states. One accord. I'm sorry. Mm-hmm. Did they have a list of those states? I never knew that.
You could definitely Google. You could definitely look it up. Yeah, but it's some states who have never done it, and then some in the past few years they say they're just gonna do away with it. Because I was just having this discussion actually recently, and the discussion I was having was, you know, we're here in the DMV. What if Maryland say they're gonna do it, but Virginia and DC don't? You know how damn that would be. So it's very, very interesting, and you know, maybe more apropos that this now known as the Sunshine Protection Act. We'll be going into place, but how do you feel about that? How do you feel though, you guys, when we got to do the fall back, the spring forward? Like, does it throw you off? Do you feel like if it changed that it would be better for us as a whole?
It's better for me because I work outside.
I was about to say, yeah, I just think we adjust, and I adjust. Mm-hmm. Like springtime, I do naturally get up earlier. Like I'm up at 5. So I like that because now that the time has changed, I can get to work earlier. I can end my work day earlier. Then I have more time to do other things. Mm-hmm. So the fact that it gets later, I like that. I don't mind that at all because works out for me. You know what I'm saying? I ain't going to hold you. I woke up late today, though. I was sleeping real good. My alarm didn't go off at all. And my body alarm clock didn't go off either. I mean, either. But hey, you know, it works out eventually. You know what I'm saying? We adjust.
We do. Lucky, do you want to tackle the next topic? Because this is fashion forward.
Oh, okay.
She was like, I wasn't ready, bitch. Don't do that.
We're losing you. Morehouse Twitter debates, the talented 10th trends. I am loving this. Because Ralph Lauren got to redeem themselves anyway from a long time ago when they made that statement along with Tommy Hilfiger too. And I'm with it. I'm so with it. They're doing this exclusively for Morehouse and Spelman College. It includes outerwear, knits, tailored suits, dresses, footwear, accessories, and more reference styles from the 1920s and the 1950s. I'm definitely going to make sure I tap in on this collection. It was designed again with the alumni for Morehouse and Spelman. And the first brand, it was produced campaign and all black cast and photography and creative directors. This basically the whole staff, the whole creative team was black. Everybody was black. I ain't about to go down the whole list, but I am so just proud of this because Ralph Lauren always has a way to align themselves with whatever fashion trends that we tend to set, and they've been very, very good. More of a kudos. I'm not always looking for acceptance, but when it comes to fashion, I love seeing a reflection of us because I feel like everything we do, everything that we've ever done, it stems from us. When it comes to fashion, culture, music, art, just anything, that's us. You know what I'm saying? So shout out to and Spelman and Morehouse. Hopefully this brings a lot more funding and also awareness to HBCUs as well too. So shout out. This is a good look. Go ahead.
Definitely. So Ralph Lauren did pledge to $2 million of support to scholarships for students at Morehouse and Spelman, and then 10 additional HBCUs through the UNCF, you guys, all the way through it ended, I guess, in December 2021. But they said that they're actively facilitating career pathways for Black talent. I think that that's important. A lot of companies overlook how important the Black face is. And when I say Black face, I don't mean just having people there are Black to meet your quota, but having people who are there, these are the people who buy your product, and this is what they need to see. This is who's creating. This is who is tuned in. This is who, you know, can help to really build the brand. So I'm also excited. I don't really rock Ralph Lauren too often, I'm gonna be quite honest, but I would if I feel were that.
I don't either, but I like the I like it. Am I gonna go buy it? No.
Yeah.
But I like it.
Like if I ever grow up for real and gotta wear a bit like business suits and stuff like that, or if I had to, you know, be like on some Michelle Obama type shit, yeah, I would. I'm not even gonna hold you. I would wear some of those because in my mind, when I grow up, that's how I'm gonna be like Michelle Obama, Jackie.
But we need that type of mind.
I would wear some of those.
Yeah.
No, you can hold on. Wait, y'all can do that. We can trust me. I can do that for y'all from the thrift store. It don't take nothing to do
I'm
that
telling
look
you, at all. Get it hooked
but
up.
At the end of the day, I'm not like I personally don't wear a lot of Ralph Lauren clothes. I do love their knit, the cable knit sweaters, but I buy for my son. That's what his dad and their entire family wears. So it's like if you're not, you know, I'm just used to that per se. But yeah, I'm not. We could definitely pull off that look without pulling off that bank. You know what I'm saying? We don't need all
okay.
that.
$5 a gallon. Okay.
Yeah, $5 a gallon. We ain't even look. And they keep talking about 50% off sale. We don't care, Ralph Lauren. I'm not, driving nowhere near.
Hitting up the thrift store. Yo, I seen this chick today with a leather hoodie that was dope as fuck. I haven't seen a leather hoodie.
Love it.
I haven't in my life. Yeah. Okay, but she's like, oh no, I got this for $6 at the thrift store. I'm like, bitch,
they sleep on the consignment in the thrift stores. One of my favorite stores is a consignment store. You know, I go home, I go there and I get a whole cart full of stuff. They don't be by day. I get the little coupons, everything. But yeah, I get stuff that's never even been touched. And don't get me wrong, if I do get it, I'm getting it for half or 75% off. Cool, but it's gonna look brand new to the season. Hey, you feel me?
Talking about thrift store,
boom.
This $2.50 thrift store.
That's all you need. Hear. What's up?
You know what I'm saying? To hear, I'm not even mad.
But it's all about how you put on clothes. It's not how much you spend money on.
Yeah,
Kanye walk around looking a hot ass mess, and he's spending $1,000 on his clothes and his winter boots in the spring. So it's different, you know what I'm saying? Like, put a trash bag on me and I'm still gonna pump.
It just depends me with a waist belt, bitch, and some heels.
It just depends on your confidence and where you at in life. Like, can't shame me, baby. I know I look good. Tell me something different on you. That's what we
I love it. I love it. So you guys, you all already know what it's getting time for. Stiletto's about to take us into a really dope mix. And coming up after her mix, our guest will be in the building. Yay. Journalist, you guys, content creator, Soren Baker, Unique Access Entertainment. He's been in the game, you guys, for hip-hop and just... Yes, he's been an editor at The Source. He has helped to write and has written so many books. We're going to dive into all of them, and we're going to have a good time. So we're going to let Stiletto do her mix. You guys will be right back.
2 seconds. I'm ready.
Okay. We're going to give you 2 seconds.
Hey. DJ Stiletto.
Hi, y'all. I know our guest is in the building, so I ain't gonna hold him up too much, but we are gonna potty a little bit. Just a little bit. Let's get it. Hey.
You know, need this together for some time. And I've been experiencing some kind of killer that's changing me to break for the better. And I hope that you've been feeling the same way. And pray that you ain't running game. Hey, just what if you have to say?
Jumps up on the scene with a lean and a pocket full of green. The green doesn't symbolize the made it on the top, but RoboCop last year was a shock. The tone of the pop I could shift your butt. Kids are screaming to me, the yes says what kind of music is this for you to dance to? The man RoboCop last year was a shock. Leave the smack in the crack or the whack or the ball in the knock with a smile like that. Leave the knife and the gun in the store and ignore temptation sent by the nation. Racial game for this pain needs a new rep. In your heart and mind, never forget who's that. Walking to when you're walking, you know just what. Black on black, remember that it's important. Anyway, the shuttle is one, bring forth the fun, no hatred. The
all right, y'all. Y'all ready to bring it back? I got our guest in.
Yes, welcome, welcome, welcome.
Sing it.
Freedom ride.
Gotta love Chubb Rock, man. Stilettos putting it down.
Yeah.
That
yeah.
Chubb Rock, Kwame, some of my favorites.
Okay, yes.
Kwame
got
my heart. Anyway. Kwame has had my heart since the 1980s. Since I was a little kid.
Well, I admire him for different reasons.
Love Kwame.
Yeah, me too. This he's one of my friends, so I'm fortunate that that's the case these days.
Well,
yeah.
You tell him that I'm almost 40, and I've been loving him since I was in elementary school.
Mm. What you say? Send a message, says what you say.
To this day, you can play some Kwame, and I'm on it. I'm ready. You got. Welcome to Illustrated Radio.
Yeah, thank you for having me. I appreciate it.
So you have done so many dynamic things in the world and in the culture of hip hop, from being a journalist to being a writer to covering some of the biggest things, biggest names. What to date is the thing that you're most proud of?
Really, it's that I really have been able to live my dream. You know, when I was 10 is when I fell in love with rap. And when I was 12 is when I was like, man, I got to figure out how I could be involved in this. And I grew up in Gambrills, right in between Baltimore and Washington. So, you know, my parents were school teachers and I didn't have any connection to anything in the music industry at all. So I was like, man, you know, how could I be down? So I tried to figure it out. And You know, when I was 12, I distinctly remember being on the basketball court and telling my friend I wanted to meet Schoolie D, my friend Sean Craig, and we were just talking about it. And, you know, I've been able to live my dream of my whole life. So that is what I'm most proud of, because I knew as a 12-year-old what I wanted to do, and I also knew that I had to figure it out because I didn't have an uncle in the game. I didn't have a cousin that was a rapper. I didn't know anybody that was a DJ. I just had to figure it out. Mm-hmm. And fortunately, and knock on wood, I've been able to do it to where today I have friends like Kwame, like for real, we talk on the phone and hang out sometimes. So, I mean, it's just, it's just crazy. And I gotta, you know, just keep pushing. So,
mm-hmm. Yeah. And that's the beauty in it all. The fact that you're from here, you're from this area, you're doing everything that you love. You worked with some really amazing people and you've done some great things. So, outside of doing what you love, what is editorially, like, what was your favorite magazine or form of writing or piece of work that you've done, or your book as well? What was your favorite part of doing that?
Well, I did bring my books just so I could show them to everybody to make sure if you don't have them, go get them.
It's extensive. Not only that, they're in a lot of different languages as well, too, right?
Yeah, the history of gangster rap is obviously it's in English, but we also got it in Japanese, Russian, Spanish, and Italian. And then
you speak those languages?
No.
Okay.
No. One of my brothers is fluent in Spanish. My other brother's fluent in French, and then my mom is a French teacher. So,
okay.
But I'm not inclined on any of the languages.
That's okay. Mama got you. Don't trip.
I speak rap, I guess.
Yeah, but, I like that. I speak rap.
But, Mama gonna hold it down.
And go. So yes, but the thing is, you know, the most exciting thing is hard to say because I really have lived my dream and I've had so many amazing experiences to where, you know, on the keeping it in Maryland, I mean, I was able to, you know, I've met Kool Herc, who created the hip hop culture by most people's standards. And then I also got to meet and spend time with Chuck Brown, who created Go-Go. So I kind of live that dream of being able to meet and spend time with both of them. And obviously Chuck has passed, but you know, I got to meet him and interview him several times over the years. And, you know, that was an amazing experience every time getting to talk to him. And on one of his live albums, they actually put one of my quotes on the back of the album for people that might have.
So that was the quote.
It says something to the effect of decades before juveniles making women back that ass up, Chuck Brown had been doing it throughout DC. Something to that effect.
I kind of remember that quote. That's what's up.
Yeah.
Okay, so within the culture of hip hop, like you said, you've done so many things, from being an editor to being a writer. You have these long-standing friendships, but a lot of the people that you have friendships with, they have taken the culture, they put it on their back, and they, you know, have built conglomerates, they have put back into the community, have done so many things at what they feel is their responsibility to the culture. What is your responsibility to the hip hop culture?
My responsibility is, I have many different responsibilities. One is, as a journalist, is just to be journalistically sound in what I do. Mm-hmm. So since I do a lot of different things within what I do, like, one, I'm a journalist. So when I'm doing that, I have to, you know, stick to the facts, make sure things are reported and balanced. Mm-hmm. And I make a point, just generally speaking, as a person, I'm not very sensationalistic. So thankfully, I stay away from that. But journalistically, that's what I do. But then also when I'm being creative, whether that's writing a book or working with an artist or anything else that I do, I just always try to do my best to deliver the best product because I got into all this because I love it. And I always want to be genuine and come at everything from a place of respect and admiration because... Mm. You know, as you guys may be aware, or ladies, I should say, as y'all ladies may be aware, when we were growing up, and that rap wasn't necessarily embraced. It wasn't necessarily the cool thing. Mm-hmm. And even in Maryland, you know, as y'all know, it was more, much more go-go in DC, and in Baltimore, it was house music. So mm-hmm. rap was probably second best in either DC or Baltimore.
Yeah.
That's but true. But for me, it was number one, and go-go was number two. So
I was gonna say, for a lot of us, I think it was number one and number two too.
Yeah. So mm-hmm. so I just try to like really do my best to represent it and come at it from a place of appreciation. Tycoon 0822 do a documentary. I've actually done some documentaries on rap that people could check out. I wrote and produced two with Tech N9ne out of Kansas City. About his career. The first one was the Tech N9ne Experience, and then the second one was the Psychumentary. So I wrote and produced both of those, and I directed, co-directed the second one, the Psychumentary. Nice. Mm-hmm. I did also one with Chingy around his Powerballin' album. And then for VH1, the biggest thing I've written and produced so far for television that's come out is I did an Ultimate Albums episode on the Marshall Mathers LP.
Ooh,
so I got to interview. Yeah, that was incredible. I got to interview Eminem and Dr. Dre and Snoop Dogg and Exhibit and Jimmy Iovine and a whole
bunch
of
people. So why you don't do a documentary of yourself? Like you and all of like you had one of. We're not talking about the people.
You took it right out of my mouth.
Yeah, well.
Damn people. We talking about you.
Yeah, I need.
Damn the book. No, I mean, not damn the book. Get the book, y'all. Both of the books. But a documentary about you. We want to hear your story. You, like, you know.
Yeah, I need to get on that. Actually,
it's bigger.
I'm going to write a. I've got a couple of things I'm going to work on to that end. So I agree.
Okay, great.
You know, because
we get to get premiere and we get to come and do the red carpet when you have that.
Let's make it happen. You know, because one time, it's funny you say that, the first time I really got this. Someone suggested this to me was Juicy J. I was with, because I've written about and been friends with 3-6 Mafia since the late 90s when they were first getting big nationally. Mm-hmm. And I was with them a couple years later in Memphis. And Juicy J, I was getting ready. I actually went on stage with them for a little bit, but Juicy J, before they started performing, he kind of pulled me to the side. He's like, yo, man, you know you're like that dude in Almost Famous, but you the rap one. You know, that's you, man.
It's true. That's you.
So,
first off, let me say this. 3-6 Mafia think I'm crazy. I used to tour with Diplo and Mase Razor.
Okay.
So we had a show and they was in it, but Dip didn't tell me that they were our like people, like our, you know, people we was headlining with. So I didn't know. And I went in there real drunk, didn't know. And I walked in and I was like, oh, and I started dancing. It was like, oh, she's crazy. Ever since then, it's like, oh, you got the crazy dancer. I'm like, true, I'll take you.
Okay.
Crazy. I love it. You yeah. need to tell about your story. You got stories.
That's yeah, and somebody asked, I saw in the comments if I had been back to Maryland. I go usually once or twice a year at least to visit my parents. They still live in Maryland. And, but the pandemic slowed things down. So I only have gone once since the pandemic, but hopefully I'll get back. That was Uptown King 77. So that hit that comment. But yes, okay. I still come back to Maryland. And, you know, when the History of Gangster Rap came out, my dad taught at Bowie High School. So I did a signing at the Barnes & Noble at Bowie. So that was pretty incredible. And Joe Claire had me on the radio. I'm friends with him for a long time. So that was incredible to be able to go back home and represent and, you know, get on the radio that I grew up listening to. So, you know, it's pretty amazing.
You have to tell your story. You have to.
You guys are inspiring me to do so even more because I've been.
You know, when you hear it in the universe once, it means that's a sign, and you heard it from different sources. So at the end of the day, it's something that you just know that your steps are leading you to anyway. You just got it.
Yep, it's on the way.
Mm-hmm.
I know that's right. So your book, The History of Gangsta Rap. Now, I just got to know. How much of gangsta rap really was gangsta? Okay. Because some of the stuff that we listen to that we grew up on and the images that we saw, you know, they'd be super hard, super whatever. But then if you really break down some of these albums, some of that shit was funny. Some of this shit was talking about live sex. Like,
questionable. Like, did that really happen?
Yeah. Whoa. Like, how much of gangster rap really is gangster, in your opinion, from the beginning and then maybe to now?
Well, I'd say it's probably a lot more than you realize, because the reality of it is, and this is looking at it in an extreme, sad, negative way, look at all the deaths of the artists involved in gangster rap. And that shows you how real it is, because sadly, we've lost a lot of the greatest artists in the genre through violence. And this is all a reflection, as everyone here and everyone listening knows, it's a reflection of what's going on in the streets. You know, art, music and art reflects what's happening in society. So this is, gangster rap has always just been a reflection of what's going on in the United States, and especially obviously in the ghetto, and especially with Black men in particular. So this is something that's been going on long before gangster rap, and gangster rap's rise, I think, really just highlighted especially the injustices that go on in America to Black men in particular, but obviously the entire Black community and brown community for that matter. Gangster rap really highlighted all that and showcased it in a way that hadn't really been done, I would argue, in any way.
In any way. It put it on front page, and gangster rap just wasn't talking about like being a gangster and actually killing people and robbing and stealing. It was actually talking about some of the things and the struggles that they dealt with on a day-to-day basis as well. So like you said, it definitely did highlight that.
Yeah, and I think that's one of the things I attempted to do with the history of gangster rap, is show the brilliance, the thought, the insight, the perspective that a lot of these artists had, because a lot of these guys that were writing these songs, they're extremely intelligent and have amazing insight into our society, into the world. And, you know, starting from Schoolie D and Ice-T in particular, with those two gentlemen, I mean, Schoolie D on PSK is talking about he was going to, you know, shoot this dude, but he said, no, with my educated mind, I don't want to do the time. So he even though he had a gun and was talking about using it to kill this dude, he, you know, looked at it from an educational perspective or educated perspective. And then Ice-T, who became far more popular as far as selling records, and obviously is an icon on many levels now with his acting on Law & Order SVU and all of his commercials.
Detective T.
Yeah, Finn, for those that know. But the thing is that, you know, Ice-T also was breaking down. Schoolie D was out of Philadelphia, and then Ice-T from New Jersey and then moved to Los Angeles, he was breaking down the gangs that most people are familiar with, of course, the Bloods and the Crips, but he was breaking it down as to the life of that type of environment in Los Angeles. And, you know, Ice-T, you know, he gave me so many great interviews from my book, The History of Gangster Rap, but one of the best things he said is that he always wanted to show the horrors that went along with this life. You know, a lot of times it's presented in the media that, oh, these guys are just glamorizing violence and stuff. But if you listen to what Schoolie D, what Ice-T, what Eazy-E, what NWA, DJ Quick, a lot of other artists, Compton's Most Wanted, were saying over the years, there's a lot of death involved in this. There's a lot of pain involved in this. There's a lot of people's brothers or sisters getting, you know, addicted to drugs. This is all discussed in the music. And none of that is glamorous. None of that is glorifying it. You know, NWA, NWA, if you guys remember the song Dope Man, that's that's a song where they're rapping about. Yeah, but they're talking about what the dope man does and how he's destroying the neighborhood. He's destroying the community. They're not endorsing it. And then when at the last verse, when Eazy-E comes on and raps about things from the dope man perspective, he's clearly a horrible dude. Like, that's not the guy that you would want to be down with. He's like despicable. And that is something that I think people have to really understand. If they really, they get blinded by the profanity or the violence or the N-word or the B-word or this or that, and they don't understand or pay attention to what the artists are talking about. And that's the reality. And that's what I wanted to do and hope I did a good job of showing through my book, The History of Gangster Rap, that there's a lot of thought that goes into this, and it is reflecting some of the worst parts of our society. And these are, you know, voices from the voiceless. And, you know, I think gangster rap, on top of that, when you look at Snoop Dogg, Ice Cube, Dr. Dre, and Ice-T, those are four of the biggest people in entertainment, period, not rap. Mm-hmm. And they all are gangster rap. That's where they come from.
So how do you feel about, because you've been in the space of these legends coming up and what they've been through and how they turned their lives around, how do you feel about the rappers that we have now compared to like, you know, just even rap music? How do you feel is the difference, you know, what's the difference for you?
The primary difference is that when I was growing up, just to make up numbers, there might have been 100 rappers. Now there's 1,000 rappers. So when I was growing up, those 100 rappers, let's just use a high number, I liked 85 of them or something. Mm-hmm. But now there's not 85% of the rappers that I like. And that's partially because of the sheer volume. You know, when I was growing up, there weren't that many rappers from my area in Anne Arundel County, PG County, DC, Baltimore County area. There really weren't that many. And then the ones that got on, most of them rapped over house beats, or in Baltimore rapped over goat or part of a go-go group or something. Mm-hmm. And then you had like Stinky Dink and DC Scorpio and some of the other early artists.
Taking it back.
Yeah, I got to see, quick side note, I did see Stinky Dink at Bowie State one time. So that was great. That was awesome. Tony Medley is asking, who's my favorite go-go band? That's a very difficult question, but I met Chuck Brown, so he's probably my favorite, but I would also have to say like Rare Essence.
I was gonna say R.E. all day.
Rare Essence. It's gotta be Rare Essence, because not only did I get to see them perform several times, but as everyone knows, they have some phenomenal music.
Yeah, they do.
So R.E. It's gotta be the R.E.
Oh, shucks, man. Listen, y'all, if it weren't for Rare Essence, your girl wouldn't be here, okay? Mm. My parents met at a Rare Essence go-go.
Oh, there you go.
Listen, and when I met White Boy, I told him that. I said, yo, you low-key my uncle, my god uncle. If it wasn't for you,
unofficial,
I wouldn't be here right now.
Right. Yeah. Now, they're incredible. And I got to see him at the Capitol Center. Was the biggest place I saw him perform. So, like, at the time, that's, you know, 18,000 people approximately. Mm-hmm. So like, to, you know, I've seen go-go shows at small venues throughout DC, of course, but then to be able to see a full-fledged big show at the Capitol Center, that was amazing. They were actually, Styletta
really
was playing
a whole memoir.
Styletta was playing Chubb Rock earlier. I got to see Rare Essence with they performed with Chubb Rock one time.
Ooh, for real?
Oh, wow.
At the Capitol Center.
I love that.
Wow. Yes. Yeah.
That was amazing.
Let's take a second to get into the Gucci Mane Guide to Greatness.
Yes,
tell us about that book. Tell us about working with him, and how can we all be great?
Well, one, you could buy the Gucci Mane Guide to Greatness and check it out, read it. There's a lot of great information in there. But the working with him was amazing. I had when he was on Warner Brothers Records, I was going to, and this is in the mid-2000s, I was going to write a commercial for him for one of his albums that was coming up. But it didn't end up happening, given to a lot of his legal stuff. So fast forward about a decade later, it was awesome when the opportunity came to me to be able to write this book, The Gucci Mane Guide to Greatness, because, you know, he's extremely intelligent and very focused and very business oriented. Mm-hmm. So, you know, the idea was to take a lot of stuff that he puts on social media and make a book out of it and have him kind of break down. I'll just pull some out. So he'll like tweet a lot of things. So like one of the entries is Work in Silence. So, you know, we basically go throughout the book, the Gucci Mane Guide to Greatness, and talk about what does work in silence mean to him? How did he get that idea? How does he live that in his life? And how has that helped him? And Gucci is extremely articulate and we had a great time working on the book. And, you know, it's been extremely well received. That one, I should have brought the paperback too, but we got this one, the hardcover, the original version. And then it just came out last year, 2021, at the end of the year in paperback. So people
can. Oh, you were doing a lot of you said 2001 or 21?
2021, excuse me.
Yeah, so 2021 was a good year for you. It was your third year anniversary as well for your first book. And then, yeah, that's what's up. That was a big year.
Well, these aren't my first books. These are my most recent books.
Your most recent book. Okay.
Yeah, yeah. I got a gang of books, but these are the two most recent.
So what are some of your guides for greatness? Like, you know, if you had to tell anybody wanting to chase their dreams, especially in journalism or entertainment or anything like that, what would be some of your key imperative advice or things that you do, like work in silence, maybe that could be something, or reaching out to a team, you know, give us some tips.
Well, the two main things that definitely apply in journalism, but I think generally are very important in life, is that you have to really read and you have to write. And, you know, that doesn't matter what job you have, being able to read and comprehend things is extremely important, you know, and that goes from anything, you know, people make jokes about it, but, you know, when people like, oh, I can't read, and then they try to order food at a restaurant, it's a lot more difficult. But that's just a simple thing I've seen people talk about many times. But to be able to function, you need to be able to read. And that's a very underappreciated skill. And then writing is also very important because it's a way to articulate yourself and to get your point across. And I found that a lot of people that could write really well, like look at Gucci Mane, he's able to write in his lyrics and he, you know, has put out thousands of songs. So he's able to get his point across through his music by writing. And a lot of people just do it by talking. They don't write that much. But now with the advent of social media and texting and all these other things, of course, we write all the time, but we don't write grammatically correct or, you know.
Or with a significant meaning. Significant meaning, right.
But another skill that's very crucial to being a journalist and a writer, and I also would argue a person, is listening. And I think a lot of people don't listen. We, as a society, yes, Tycoon said most people don't like to read. It's sad. That's true. But I also think most people don't listen. And the reality, I think a lot of problems that we have as a society and in the world is that we don't listen to each other and try to understand their perspectives. And something that I try to do all the time is listen, because whether I'm interviewing somebody or talking to my friends or whoever, I gotta like listen so I know what they're trying to tell me. And, you know, as we all know, whether you're in a relationship or your parents or your kids or whatever, you gotta like understand what they're saying so that you can have the best relationship you can. And that's something that I try to do all the time. You know, obviously I'm not perfect. I have my own feelings and emotions and I get upset or whatever, but you got to like really, really listen. And that's something that I see a lot of people don't do a good job of. And people are quick to cut people off or interrupt people all the time. And it's like, nah, let me finish what I'm saying. And that's very important.
Keisha, you muted.
Yeah, I couldn't hear you.
That's a great piece of advice for me.
Oh,
I appreciate that. Like, listen, you know.
Yeah, we got somebody that just said what made me coordinate with Gucci, made me want to coordinate with Gucci. Well, his if you don't also have his first book, the autobiography of Gucci Mane, that's an excellent book. I would highly recommend. I didn't work on that at all, but I would highly recommend it because he has a remarkable story. And as we know, you know, given the societal, economic, racial inequalities that we have in America, obviously just the odds are stacked against, you know, non-white people especially. And Gucci's a good illustration of somebody that came from Alabama, dirt poor, moved to Atlanta, and then despite making tons of mistakes, and then despite being super successful, ended up incarcerated multiple times. Mm-hmm. And, you know, if we look at, you know, this is something that we see as a pattern in society, you know, whether that's Eldridge Cleaver, whether that's Malcolm X, or whether that's Gucci Mane, like, it's not that you got incarcerated, it's what do you do once you're incarcerated? And right. those three men in particular were able to turn their lives around once they were released. And Gucci, in the modern example, is somebody that, you know, used this time to change his life. He lost a lot of weight, he got off of drugs, and he dedicated himself to his wife, Keisha Kaur, and dedicated himself to totally changing his mind, his body, and his spirit, and how he operated. And that's a lot of what we cover in the Gucci Mane Guide to Greatness, these lessons that he learned along the way in his life, and then how he used them to change, to get into shape, to get off of drugs, to become super successful. And that, to me, is something that I was always admired about him as it was happening. And then talking to him and working with him on the book, I got a deeper appreciation and understanding for that by actually talking with them on a regular basis for it. So,
got you. Wow.
Well, you have a super amazing story, and you've worked with some really amazing people. You've done some awesome things, and we appreciate you for also being having integrity when it comes to the culture and understanding all of the factors that it takes into it. Racial inequalities is something that we deal with on a heavily basis. And for you to be a part of the culture and really put it on your shoulders, on your back, like, I'm excited about reading your book. I can't wait to get a signed copy because I'm going to request one, and then I can cash out. I can throw a little cash at you because I definitely want to get into the reading more and actually completing it more, because there's something about writing things and putting things pen to paper. It has a permanency to it, and it also makes it actually something that's real. So reading and writing has way more magical things behind it than, you know, just actually trying to just comprehend and read stuff. So I think it's a beautiful thing. Welcome back. Yes.
Do you walk with a pen and pad? Like, do you carry one and jot down stuff? Like, you just never.
I carry a pen. I carry a pen with me 99% of the time. Obviously, now with phones, you can write on your phone a lot more easily with notes. But there's almost always paper around if I need it wherever I happen to be. True. So that's good. But I've been thinking this way since I was probably even before I was 10, before I fell in love with rap. So, you know, I have a pretty good memory, but I also, you know, understand the importance of writing things down, because, you know, not to turn this into some self-help seminar, because, you know, we all need help, but the thing about writing things down that I've found, even if you just keep it to yourself, it's something that's not only tangible, you can touch it, see it, look at it, but it also is a thing that could also help hold yourself accountable. Mm-hmm. Like, whether that's a job thing, whether that's a personal thing, whether that's anything. Like, I want to watch the Batman. Like, if you write it down, then you remember if you haven't seen it in a week. And that's just an entertainment thing. But if you say, oh, I want to, you know, make a point to write 30 minutes every day, and it's written down, then you're going to look at it. And, you know, I have too many things written down that I want to do. But, you know, I always try to reshape that and work it out, because I'm always doing a lot of things. And I find that writing things down, you know, literally by hand. I have a pen right here since you brought it up. But the point is to have something to write it down that you can refer to and reference is very important. So highly recommend it.
So I have a question, and I know you guys, I missed a little bit. So I hope that this question wasn't already asked, but I definitely want to get this before we head out. You've mentioned more than one time, you know, the age and where you were in the space you were in when you fell in love with hip hop. But I would like to know what that experience was. Was it that song? Was it that beat? Was it the What was it when you fell in love with hip-hop?
What was the song that made you fall in love?
Come on, Sanaya. Brown sugar.
I was going to say, we're getting real brown sugary here. Yeah. But it's
a real thing for you.
Yeah, well, the thing is that so the funny story is, basically, when I was 10, I had heard rap and I knew it. And for some reason or some way, I just asked one of my boys, Tom Early, who I went to elementary school and everything with. I just said, hey, man, you know, I don't remember if I asked him if he had rap or if he knew about rap or something. But somehow it came to the point of, hey, man, what's going on with rap? I've heard some of it. I like it. And he was like, man, there's a lot of rap. And I was like, really? So he made me a tape. And
he sparked your interest.
And so on his tape, he had Dana Day Nightmares, LL Cool J, I Need a Beat. It had Roxanne, UTFO. It had...
you got to play some of that Stiletto going out.
I'm on it.
So it had all these songs, Roxanne by UTFO, at Curtis Blow with Basketball. It had Freaks Come Out at Night by Houdini. So it had, Big Mouth.
That whole list is the start of hip hop.
Literally is the start of hip hop. Everything that he played you, your era was the start of that.
Yeah. So when I heard his tape, I was blown away because I didn't know what scratching was. There was so much scratching on a lot of those songs. I didn't know what it was or how they did it or anything, but I loved the sound of it. And then those songs, because I played basketball a lot, you know, I gravitated toward that. I wanted to get at girls like Roxanne, but they were dissing me too. So I knew what that felt like. I knew what people with Big Mouth and You Talk Too Much, like Run DMC and Houdini, were talking about. So I could identify with that. So I could identify with all these different songs. And then with LL Cool J, just I Need a Beat, just the way that sounded, I was like, man, this is amazing. And with Nightmares with Dana Dane, you know, it was also like, you know, I had nightmares by that time. So, you know, I could identify with that and not knowing what's going on and being scared. So all these things I could identify with and I just thought were amazing. And then sonically, something I didn't understand till a little bit later is just I love percussion, which works well for me to like go-go. But I just happened to like it and I didn't understand how much I liked it until I heard his tape. Because a lot of those songs, some of them, the Houdini in particular, have a lot of melody, but most of the rest of them are very skeletal. There's not a lot of music to them other than the percussion. So I was drawn to all these things and I was just blown away. And that's what turned me into loving it. Like I didn't, you know, this is when I was young. There, most of those songs, none of those songs had videos at the time, and I definitely didn't see any of them. So I didn't even know the artists were black. You know, I just liked it. And obviously later, you know, growing up, as you guys know, growing up in Maryland is very racially diverse. And, you know, my neighbors were black. I had all lots of black friends and white friends. I just, where I grew up is very diverse. So the racial aspect of it didn't even hit me until probably a couple years later when I started. Thankfully, my parents aren't racist, so I didn't see or experience any of that in my house. So by the time I started learning about it, it was such a weird thing to me because it didn't make any sense. And the Joneses lived next door to us, Ed and Doris, and they would come over to our house, we'd go over to their house. So all of this stuff that I learned in society was so weird because it wasn't what I was learning.
What you grew up with.
And so anyway, it was just all amazing. And then within a couple years, you know, my dad actually was a big influence and helped me with a lot of stuff. And I didn't know until a little bit later, but he actually got his master's at Bowie State. So my dad went to HBCU too, so that's crazy.
Shout out to Bowie. My oldest daughter is there.
At Bowie State? The Bulldogs.
Yep. Yeah, she's a big
Yeah, but so the whole thing is just crazy, and I was very fortunate to have the parents that I have and, you know, grow up in Maryland because I live in LA now, or LA County now, and I love it. But Maryland's my second favorite place, and I'm very fortunate of where I grew up, and just I'm blessed that I have the parents I have and grew up in the area I did, because I got to go into Annapolis, into Baltimore, and into DC all the time, you know, whether it's to hang out or play basketball or to go to shows or to, you know, once I started being a journalist, to write. So I was very, very fortunate, and I think that Maryland is an amazing, amazing place.
Shout out to MD. We don't get a lot of love.
That's that, because your parents is here.
Yeah.
Don't worry about it.
No, I love Maryland, man. I wish I got to go more often, but it's not exactly close anymore. So it makes it a little more challenging.
On the west side?
Yeah, I'm in the LA area. LA.
Okay. Okay.
Yeah.
Well, it was a pleasure. It was great having you on. I think that you are a magical being on so many levels. Again, everything that you've done for the culture is very well respected and very well received. And we love you for it. Like, I look forward to your documentary or your autobiography as well, and whatever else. And any upcoming projects or anything that you have going on as well, because I'm sure you're a man of very many accolades. So I'm sure you're doing or currently working on something that you can probably tell us about before you go.
Well, I'm working on many things. Unfortunately, I can't, the bigger things that I'm doing, I can't talk about yet. But the main thing would be to follow me at Soren Baker, SorenBaker. And then also, I got my Unique Access Entertainment channel on YouTube. If everybody could please subscribe to that and watch my interviews for people represent Maryland. I recently got DJ Kool on there. I've also had Sugar Bear from EU on there.
Okay.
And I'm always excited to get GoGo or DC, Maryland related people on there. And then also we started putting up some of the episodes on podcasts. So, you know, wherever people listen to their podcasts, they could check those out as well. Unique Access Entertainment with Soren Baker. So, yeah.
Do you know who Crank Lucas is?
Do I know who he is? Yeah. Yes. Yeah.
We gotta get him on there. That's my homie.
You gotta get us on there.
Just for representation for music in the DMV and just people who I know grind, like Crank grinds like no other. And if you guys in the audience don't know who he is, he's the man who's responsible for the beat for Jordan Lucas when he did the song Will. But as a producer, he is just really growing leaps and bounds. I'm somebody that I'm super, super proud of, you guys, clearly. But
that's what's up.
Yeah, just in representation for the DMV, like he's doing his thing.
Yeah, I need to get him on.
Yeah.
Nice.
Most definitely.
And us.
Yes. Well,
I get the plug in anyway. Look,
well, here's the thing. Here's the thing, y'all. When whatever happens with my objective of writing my thing, whenever I get that, guys gotta either come on my show or we gotta have me come back so I can talk about it.
And give y'all definitely want to have me next time doing Game Girls. I'll meet you up at Grotto's and get you some wings.
We in there.
I like wings now.
I feel like got some of the best wings in Gambrews, y'all. If y'all ain't been there, go get them.
I'm about to go, because I'm working for me, so I'm definitely about to look up that for sure.
Yes, indeed.
But you guys, this has been Illustrate Radio right here on WEMS Radio. We want to make sure that everybody knows where to follow our guest at Soren Baker. Make sure that you also tap into him at Unique Access ENT. Lucky, tell the people where to find you. Girl.
You all can find me at Magical AF Podcast. My newest episode also just dropped, so make sure you check it out. It's on all platforms as well. And yeah, I'm excited. And I'm also doing my first speaking engagement with the Women Empowerment event with HUD. So yes, next week, Thursday, that's going to be lit. And I look forward to seeing you all next week too.
And DJ Stiletto, where can they find you?
Everywhere, DJ Stiletto. Shout out to pioneer and legendary designer and model, Jonathan Rashawn. He's having a big, big fashion show this Saturday. I am the DJ. He has a lot. He even pulled my brother, and my brother is all the way in New York, and he's coming up. So he has a lot of stuff up under his sleeve.
Well, I want to see. I want to see some of his work. You know, I love a fashion show.
I'm actually trying to work out something right now with him because of how big I just realized the show is. Like, they had to move the venue and everything, and I'm like, oh, okay, this is a production. So on that note, ladies, I will be linking with you because I might be able to bring our show
to the show.
Yeah. I saw the promo you posted, Stiletto. It looked dope.
So I'm trying to pull some shirts because I know I'm going to be there from Matt early. So if I can get y'all, if I don't know if he's going to have a red carpet, but either way, I still will want y'all to still have that experience, being that it's going to be an experience, if that makes sense. So yeah, we'll talk.
T-Gray, Lucky, and Stiletto, I just want to thank you all for having me on the show.
Thank you.
Illustrate Radio.
Don't even worry about it. You just weigh in.
Make sure you guys that you also follow me at Sex Talk with T-Gray. And if you missed it yesterday, I had sexpert and author Kiki Richardson on. You guys, definitely an episode you need to hop on YouTube and go check that out. Get some of that education in those.
Yes, get some of it.
From yesterday was amazing. Next week, I have Lost the Mac on Tuesday, live right here on WEMS. And then, of course, you already know we will be back Wednesday live for you, 9 to 10 p.m.
I got one question, though.
You good? You got one question now? Come on.
Yes. Where did your mother get the name Soren?
Well, since both of my parents are teachers, they wanted to have children with names they did not have as students. So it's actually my dad. Actually, my dad picked it out.
Okay, Daddy.
My dad was going to name all the boys. My mom was going to name all the girls, but we had three boys. So my mom kind of struck out. But
what's his name?
One of my brother's name is Dylan, and the other one is Grant.
Okay.
Oh, but so you got the whole different.
Unique Soren. I like that. I was hoping I said it right, and I did.
Yeah. But my Grant was going to be Garth, but my mom vetoed that because she was concerned about Darth Vader. So they switched it over to Grant. So my mom had a little say, at least. But I'm named after a philosopher. He's a Danish philosopher. So, yeah, it's funny. Occasionally,
that's funny, and you're in journalism.
Yeah, and occasionally when I meet people that are from Norway or Denmark, Scandinavia, they'll be like, oh, are you Scandinavian? I'm like, nah. I'm from Maryland.
I'm from Maryland.
Yeah.
You got a part of Maryland where they pronounce the word totally correct.
Okay.
I put a whole in it.
Yeah.
But this has been so much fun. Fantastic having you on. Just a dynamic interview. Thank you so much for joining us here on Illustrate Radio. We will see you all next week. Bye-bye.
Stiletto, you taking us off, Stiletto? Come on.
There you go. Little Chuck.
You can at least bob your head.
I got a funny story about that, if we got time.
Go ahead.
Don't go to the door.
You're not
going
to it. It's just a lie.
Story real quick.
Now, the thing is, I went to when Outkast was going to put out Stankonia, I went to meet with Andre 3000. And Andre 3000 played me the whole album before it came out. This is in L.A. And I remember I was let me rewind, because the Andre 3000 is part two. But the first part was the first time I ever got flown to L.A. was to interview West Side Connection. And that was in 96. I was in college. I'd never been to L.A. I'd never been flown to L.A., etc. So I'm meeting with Ice Cube, Dub C, and Mac 10 for West Side Connection Bow Down album. And so when I met with them, I realized that when they played the album, I was so into the album that I didn't take as many notes as I normally would because I was just so excited. And then the music was like, they had turned it up super loud and all that. So then fast forward, the next time I had that a similar thing, I was with Andre 3000 for Stankonia. And it was just me and him, and he was just playing the stuff. I was just taking notes. I didn't bob my head. I didn't do anything. And at the end, 3000 was like, well, did you like the album? Like, what's going on? And I told him the West Side Connection story. And I said, after that day, I never really bobbed my head or got too into it because I wanted to pay attention to what was happening so I would remember. And so I was more in tune with the music. So when Styletto put on a Chuck Brown, that's more of, I just want to listen to it, you know.
Yeah, well, listen to it. I respectfully, I love it.
And as y'all know, to see when you're able to watch Go-Go and the women dance to the Go-Go, it's a whole different thing. You just gotta watch. You gotta watch. You gotta watch.
I like you.
You gotta watch, man. There's a lot to see.
Your name is Mr. Smooth.
You know how to party out here. You gotta tell us why.
Y'all gotta watch.
You made us blush. Everybody was like,
yep.
Such girl. All right. We're going to see y'all.
Go ahead and do your
thing. Each and every Wednesday, 9 p.m. to 10 p.m. Peace and blessings. This is Illustrate Radio. Good night.
Thank you again.
Good night.
I was born by the river. I was shaking that ass. Bending over, popping pizza. I was making that cab. Bring that ass to you, boy.
Come on. Fuck you, man.